Nice to see you.
My pleasure.
Welcome. Thank you for joining us. So let me just give a brief introduction before Keith starts on his presentation. Keith grew up on a farm. And so he grew up, you know, with his family farming corn, soy, and hogs in Indiana. But it sounds like at some point you left the farm pursuing your interest in grad school at LSU under the mentorship of Dr. John Harbaugh, who was a co-developer of the Varroa sensitive hygiene line of honeybee. So something very relevant to what we're talking about today. Keith assumed his current post as professor of entomology at the University of Georgia in 1990, where he and his students study social evolution, honeybee IPM, pollination, and foraging ecology. So Keith, we're so happy that we joined the Georgia Beekeepers for their conferences late last year. And as I mentioned up front, you know, we learned a lot from watching how that conference was done. And so we're greatly appreciative of Georgia Beekeepers. And we're also quite astounded at the number of local beekeeping groups within Georgia. So you've got, you know, I don't know, we have several thousand beekeepers in New Mexico, but you probably have 20,000 beekeepers in Georgia. So welcome. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you. Am I ready to share screen?
Yes, sir.
All right. Let's see, spotlight. Okay, do you see my title screen?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
Good to go.
All righty. Well, thank you all. And first and foremost, it's an honor to be on your speakers list. I was looking through my records. I don't think I have spoken for the New Mexico group before. So hopefully this will maybe not be the last. So thank you for showing up to hear what I have to say. I've been working with bees for over 40 years now, 30 of those at the University of Georgia. And I can honestly say that I have never enjoyed my work more than I am right now. I have found honeybees to be an infinite horizon. The more you learn, the more that knowledge horizon is pushed further and further away from you. And I'm learning and studying things now that are of immense interest, not only for practicing beekeeping, but for just ordinary people. I mean, they're a real deep mine of good things to know about life on this planet and how we should live and how we should be. So that's what honeybees do for you. And they make honey and pollinate our crops. So I'm going to give you two presentations today. The first one is kind of a big picture image of bees, their natural history, some discussion about how they got to where they are today, things that you see every time you go inside a beehive, management principles about beekeeping that we just receive as given, and we don't understand where they came from. Well, I'm going to try to kind of approach our subject today from an evolutionary perspective. How did natural history shape our bee? What can we do as beekeepers to partner with that process, to see points of connection that we can grab onto for our management to make our bees more healthy and more profitable and more interesting? So that's where we're at. And then there's one particular aspect of that that I'm going to be drilling into a little more this afternoon. So I think we have here a nice little tidy two-part package. So with that, let's jump in. All right. Come on, advance. Let's advance. There we go. Right. Well, what you're seeing here is the biggest of big pictures. What I've shown here is honeybee phylogeny going all the way back to the three main divisions of life on this planet, which are the archaea, the primitive bacteria, the eubacteria, the true bacteria with nuclei in their cells, and then the eukarya, or the eukaryotes. And this is the lineage of the vast majority of the large-scale organisms that we see on Earth, the plants, the fungi, and the animals, which includes us. Technically, there is a provisional fourth main branch of life on this planet. It's sort of in discussion now of whether viruses constitute that fourth great branch of life. And there's a very robust discussion going on right now, which is rather timely, isn't it, with COVID that we're all having to deal with. So I just want to kind of talk through this, just to look in the biggest sense where our bee is coming from. They're eukaryotic cells, which means the cell contains its DNA inside a nucleus. It's not just sloshing around free in there like the prokaryotic cells. And then we have the division to the animals. And then we have there the division to the arthropods, the horseshoe crabs I'm showing there as an example. And then we have the insects, which is a branch of the arthropods. And you see how this is a hierarchy, you know, from greater and more inclusive divisions into increasingly smaller and more exclusive divisions, all the way down to our particular species or even subspecies of bees. Then we have the winged insects there in the top center, the pteragota, of which the hymenoptera are a part. And this is the order of insects that includes the ants and the wasps and the bees. From there, we have the apocrata, which are the wasp-waisted hymenopterans. Not all of them do. Some of them have very fat waists, like the sawflies. But the narrow-waisted ones give mobility to the abdomen. If you're a parasite, you can swivel that abdomen around more easily and lay an egg inside your host. Or if you are a hunting wasp, that agility also helps you sting and paralyze and kill your prey. Because after the apocrata, that's where we have is the aculeata, which are called the hunting wasps. Okay, now let's bump down to this next row. You can see aculeata coming out there on the left, and we continue. Then we have a division between the ants and the bees. And then notice this green patch at the bottom here on the bottom left. This is the arrival of the flowering plants, the angiosperms. And so it's no great surprise that following close on the heels of the arrival of the angiosperms, we have the first Anthophila, or the true bees. This is big. This is big because the bees are essentially vegetarian wasps. These are hunting wasps from the aculeata division prior. And these wasps just began noticing this new form of protein that was around the landscape, the pollen that was on these flowering plants and the nectar that the plants started producing, you know, to attract these vegetarian wasps, because the flowers were getting a good deal out of this, weren't they? These wasps that would come and pay a visit and take the pollen would fertilize subsequent flowers. And so it became a real boon to the plants to have this aid to the vectoring of their pollen. And plants in return responded with nectar, but they also responded with changes in the morphology of the flower. Flower pollens became sticky. They became knobby. They became full of tack and friction so that they could adhere more easily to the bodies of these vegetarian wasps who, for their part, were also modifying. They were getting hairier. They were getting special apparatus on their bodies for carrying pollen, long hairs that were parallel like combs that the pollen could stick to. And in some divisions, which we call the corbiculates, you see that red circle there, the corbiculates at the bottom center, these are these vegetarian wasps that started developing special structures on their legs for carrying pollen. And all of these, of course, are not vegetarian wasps, are they? We call them bees. The corbiculates are distinctive because they alone have these structures on their hind legs, and bumblebees are a part of that. So the next time you see foraging bumblebees, just take a look and you'll see that they have very specific balls of pollen on their legs. Other solitary bees just have pollen all over their bodies in a very non-specific area of the body. And this is one reason why a lot of times the solitary bees make more efficient pollinators, because they have more pollen all over their body. So it's easier for them to just accidentally make contact with the sexual column of a flower as they go from flower to flower and get pollinating done. The corbiculate bees tend to be a little neater. They have combs on other parts of their body where they can rake the pollen off their body and then pack it down into their corbiculum. They compartmentalize their pollen a little more than the solitary bees do. And that makes pollination for the corbiculates just a little bit more hit or miss. Continuing down that phylogeny of the corbiculates, we see at the bottom, we have a big division between the euglossinae and the apinae. And the euglossinae are the orchid bees or the oil collecting bees, and they're very well represented in South America. But the division, of course, that we're interested in is the apinae, the honey bees, which today includes just one genus. Now look at the next branch between Micrapus and Apis and Megapis. You see that red patch there? That red patch is the evolution of complex eusociality. We're going to talk a little bit about that today. Complex eusociality is, as we can say, it's more than just simple eusociality. A simple eusociality can be nothing more than a mother and her daughters. But in complex eusociality, we have division of labor, and we have some of those division groups that are defined by reproduction. Some reproduce, some don't. And all of this comes together in the truly social or the eusocial grades. And the apinae are universal in expressing eusociality. I'm having to crunch the time chronology on that x-axis by now, and things are starting to heat up and happen faster and faster. Around 300,000 years ago, roughly, we have the emergence of more or less modern Apis mellifera. But within a scale of tens of thousands of years, we have their radiation out into some of the lineages that we begin to recognize today. See, crammed up there against the far right on the bottom, we have the M lineage of Apis mellifera, which gave rise to Apis mellifera mellifera and Apis mellifera iberica. Both of which are significant for the American Southwest, because Iberica, of course, from the Spanish Peninsula, and it's this race that was largely moved in colonial times by Spaniards into the New World. The C lineage is of interest to beekeepers, because this includes Apis mellifera carnica, the carniolans, and our beloved Apis mellifera ligustica. The A lineage stands for Africa, and of course, the most famous representative of that group is the modern Apis mellifera scutellata, also of key interest to beekeepers. Well, during that very brief course through the history of honeybees, a lot of things happened about that eusociality thing and what bees in nature can teach us. And a big part of that I'm interested in has been honeybee queen multiple mating. This is a picture that shows her in the act. We know as beekeepers, it's well known that queens mate with many males. Traditionally, if you read some of the literature about honeybee breeding, the authors almost treat that apologetically. They say, gosh, you know, the breeder is selecting for a character the breeder likes. And usually we do that maternally. We find a colony that has a character we like and we propagate queens from it. But when it comes to the mating, we just sort of hope for the best, don't we? We turn these virgins loose in mating yards and at best, we may stock a yard with drone stock that we like. And literally we hope for the best. So this is very different from what the honeybee does for using genetics to solve its problems. We bee breeders, we beekeepers, in our short lifespans and in our limited perspective and in our very narrow interests, we can't help but be narrow in our selecting outcomes. Think about it. If I'm interested in honey production or gentleness or varroa mite resistance, I'm going to select generation after generation after generation, and I may get what I want, but at what cost? I'm losing other things too that may be of equal or greater importance simply from neglect. It's simply gene attrition. And this we call a genetic bottleneck effect. Whenever we push a population through a bottleneck, like a deliberate breeding program, it's very hard to avoid the loss of other genes which may be of equal importance. This is a big problem with any kind of artificial breeding scheme. We in our short lifetimes cannot take in the full picture of what the bee needs to optimally survive. We may get the thing we want, but it may come at a significant cost. Honeybees just dispense with all of that with this habit of multiple mating. We see in the history of the honeybee an elaborate bid for diversity, not narrowness. Okay? They have an elaborate bid for genetic diversity in the nest, not for genetic narrow specialization. This happens many ways. First of all, in the stage of forming their gametes, the sexual cells, the eggs and the sperm. When the chromosomes pull apart and form an egg or a sperm, they then go through another process where the chromosomes will exchange genetic material with each other before they pull apart. And that is yet one more way of scrambling up the individual's genome to make sure that there's a lot of variation on each sperm or egg that goes out. Well, that's one way they like diversity, and honeybees are extremely high. In fact, I think they're the highest known recombination rate of all the animals in the formation of our eggs and sperm. There's a lot of scrambling that goes on in the process of forming honeybee eggs and sperm. A second way this happens is through the drone congregation areas. We know from work that was done back in the 70s in Germany that up to 200 colonies can be represented in one drone congregation area. That's how many different colonies drones participate in a given drone congregation area. So this is very plainly a bid, an attempt. It's an adaptation for trying to create highly diversified colonies. Incidentally, have you ever noticed with a drone that has ejaculated, if you have squeeze them, if you're practicing instrumental insemination, you notice these two horns that come out the back of the drone when his endophallus comes out. They're bright orange. Well, normally in ecology and in animal populations, we tend to think that males are very competitive, and they try. In fact, we see that in other bee species, don't we? In mating congregation areas of solitary bees or carpenter bees, you'll see males chasing each other away. You see it in hummingbirds, right? Where the hummingbird males will chase off their competitors because it's to the male's advantage to not share paternity with another male. Well, honeybee males do the exact opposite. Those horns that come out of their endophallus, which remain in the female temporarily, are like a flag that actually attracts other males. They're actually saying, helping each other, saying, hey, I mated with this queen, you come along and you mate with her too. This is very different from the norm in most animal mating systems. And it's thought to be yet another adaptation for drones. It's to the individual drone's advantage if the queen he's mating with mates with many males, if it makes her colony stronger. So this is another way we see an evolution, how over and over again, we see cooperation is elevated at least as high as selfish survival of the fittest. My personal soapbox, I think a lot of evolution gets fed a bad polemic for ethical or moral reasons because it promotes selfishness, right? We don't want that. Well, yes, that's true, but it's equally true that oftentimes the best way to be selfish and to help my genes get propagated is to cooperate. So cooperation is at least, if not more important to selfishness in the whole grand paradigm of evolution. And far too rarely do we ever hear that side of the story. And then the third and final way in which queens get lots of diversity in their nest is through multiple mating. And a very deep literature has shown that colonies whose queens have mated multiply are much more vigorous colonies. And you're going to see this here in the next few minutes. It's only in colonies that are genetically diverse that we see the size and the behavioral complexity that we have come to recognize in honeybees. And this is true of the ants and the termites as well. Now, the ants and termites may pursue it differently, through a different strategy. Oftentimes in your ants and termites, you will have multiple queens in one nest, each queen of whom is singly mated to one male. So whether you use multiple queens, each with one mate, or one queen with multiple mates, the end result is the same. Diversity inside the social insect nest, not narrowness. Well, okay, how does that diversity and that complexity and that behavioral complexity look? Well, we have known for a long time that honeybees go through a fairly predictable sequence of tasks as they age. And this is a summation of the literature that I have made for a book I'm working on in honeybee social evolution that will be coming out early next year from Johns Hopkins Press. But what I've done here is take meta-analysis of data from the literature and plotted it here to show you the average age of worker bees as they perform a sequence of tasks. Generally, they start with indoor tasks and then they work their way down to outdoor tasks. Cleaning cells tends to be the earliest, and feeding brood, capping brood, attending the queen, grooming, feeding, ventilating, working with comb, packing pollen, nectar, guarding, and then finally foraging. Foraging is, of course, the riskiest of these tasks, and virtually no worker survives it. You know, this is the end of the rope. Now, you'll notice there is a general slight shift to the right. So bees do tend to do these in a sequence of time, from younger to older. But it doesn't take me to point out to you how much overlap there is. The overlap is huge. And this is built into the system. Worker bees are able to precociously jump ahead and do an older task if they need to, if the colony warrants. If, for example, you have a pesticide kill in the field that kills all your foragers, some of your younger bees will be able to precociously jump ahead and become foragers. And the reverse of that is true. If you have a contaminated pollen that kills all of your young bees, then some of the older bees can abandon foraging and revert back to more juvenile behavior and return to nursing brood. So that's built into the structure of the hive. And the more of these behaviors that we have represented, the more fit the colony will be. Now, what is hidden inside these data bars that I'm showing you here are specialists. There are some individuals who pretty much stick with one task. We actually have examples in the literature of individuals who spend their entire life doing one thing. Now that's extreme. Granted, most of them do go through this sequence that I'm showing you, but it's not at all uncommon for some of them to linger or to spend more time at one particular task than others. And very often that specialization can be traced to a particular drone lineage. In other words, these specialisms very often resolve to the level of a subfamily inside the nest. One particular drone, one drone and all of his daughters in the nest. So this helps us understand why it can be so adaptive for a queen to mate with many, many males. She increases the possibility that she will capture a lot of specialists in each of these tasks so that there will always be some who are really, really good at particular tasks. Now, with instrumental insemination, we have the ability to test some of these ideas. I have laid out for you here today two very different approaches to using genetics to solve honeybees' problems. One of them is the natural way. The queen mates with lots of males and hopes that she captures lots of specialists who tend to be rare. And that's an important point to hang on to. Specialists, by definition, are rare. You know, you don't have common specialists. You know, that's an oxymoron, isn't it? But there's a reason for these specialists to be rare, to be recessive in their inheritance, to be few in number. And the reason it's adaptive for the genetic structure of a population to have its specialists be rare is because a colony made up exclusively with specialists would be a disaster. Imagine a colony that was really, 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 really good at foraging for pollen. Well, it may do a really good job at collecting pollen, but once again, it won't be good at air conditioning its nest, or it won't be good for foraging for nectar, or you get the idea. We don't want a monolithic colony. We do want lots of specialists. And one way to do that is for natural selection to make those genes controlling them rare. Well, that's one way of using genetics. The second way of genetics, of course, is the human way, right? We have a trait that we like, and we select for it and propagate it generation after generation, and probably succeed to some degree. Well, there's a character out there that seems to fit the bill as of a specialist that is highly beneficial, and that's hygienic behavior. I'm showing you here in this little diagram how breeders can select for this. Hygienic behavior is the ability of a stock of bees to recognize a cell of brood that is abnormal. It may have a parasite in it. Excuse me. It may have a brood pathogen in it. It may have small hive beetle eggs in it. And these bees are able to open up these cells, pull out the contents, and in the process, they interrupt the life cycle of the pathogen or the parasite. And this, at the colony scale, can be very effective at removing parasites and pathogens from the nest. And of course, this is effective against varroa mites. And we have many breeders around the country today and the world who are selecting for varroa sensitive hygiene. This line is particular to varroa mites in the brood cells, and they detect them and open them. Well, one way that you can test for this, if you're a breeder, is to use the freeze killed brood system, where you take a cylinder, a PVC pipe, it's hard to beat, and you kind of screw it into a section of solid sealed brood. You count the number of skips, and then you pour in liquid nitrogen out in the field. And within minutes, it freezes that brood solid as rock. And then you take that section of freeze-killed brood and put it back in the colonies. And then after 24 hours, you come back and check it again. In the thumbnail at the bottom right, you see a colony that's expressing a mediocre degree of hygienic behavior, whereas the colony on the left is expressing 100% hygienic behavior. It's a proxy. It's a secondhand method of selecting for hygienic behavior. So if that was the character I was interested in, I would propagate from the queen on the bottom left. And this is what we did in a study that we just finished. We're getting this paper reviewed and responding to the reviewers right now. We were interested in comparing two things. Let's just hit this tension square on. Let's look at natural use of genetics, artificial use of genetics, and combine the two. And here's what we did, Debbie Delaney and I. We were too interested in two things: polyandry, multiple mating at two different levels. In Delaware, we inseminated virgin queens with either one drone or four. In Georgia, we inseminated virgin queens with either 9 drones or 54. Now, why these different numbers? It has nothing to do with biology, and it has everything to do with overwintering success. Delaware had a huge winter loss of their drone colonies, whereas we in Georgia got by okay. And that's why we have these two different extremes of polyandry that were tested in our two states. So against low and high polyandry, we wanted to test the presence of VSH semen versus wild type semen. So there you have it, two things: polyandry, artificial selection, each of which had two levels of expression. And so we put them together in this matrix, and all four possibilities were expressed. We had VSH drones, we had wild type drones, inseminated to wild type virgins at either 1 and 4 drones or 9 and 54 drones. Here we are the day we set this out. That's Debbie on the far back left. That's Kirsten Trainer on the extreme left. She was there that day to help us. Crispin Given from Purdue is in the middle right behind me. And Jennifer Berry, whom I think some of you know, is in the back waving her shawl in the air. This is our apiary that we used for the Georgia replicate. We did these in circles just to minimize drift. So each of these queens was inseminated in the manner that I showed you before, and then we tracked them for colony strength. Okay, let's look first at the averages across polyandry, beginning at the 11 o'clock position with the Delaware brood. Okay, in Delaware, there was more brood and colonies inseminated with 4 drones over 1 drone. In Georgia, there was more bees in colonies with 54 drones instead of inseminated with 9. In Georgia, at the 4 o'clock position, there was more comb with 54 drones than 9. In Delaware, the 8 o'clock position, I'm sorry, the 8 o'clock position, there was more comb with 4 drones inseminated queens than 1. I mean, you don't need me to interpret this for you. Polyandry really works. And I get excited at results like this because if you have ever tried to breed queens, and I know you have, it's a lot of work. You have to measure the character that you're interested in. You have to propagate from the colonies that express it. You got to rear those virgins, and then you got to mate them. And then usually you have to wait 12 months before you get the results of the next generation. It takes a long time to do classical selection. And so I look at data like these and I say, you know, you can get the same results with just making your queens highly polyandrous. I mean, these are pretty clear data of the benefits of just straight polyandry, okay? But we did more than that in this study, didn't we? We were interested in the effects of VSH. So let's average all of our results across whether they had VSH semen or wild type semen. It's not quite as interesting, is it? Look at the 11 o'clock position with Delaware. No difference in brood. Georgia, no difference in bee populations. Georgia comb, no difference. In fact, the only character that was significantly different across semen types was in Delaware, and that was with comb production, and it was higher with the wild type semen. And this, I think, gets us back to a comment I've said earlier about a liability in artificial selection that is unavoidable. I mean, we in our finite lifetimes and our finite resources and finite vision, we cannot capture the universe of genetic possibilities that natural selection can with species in nature. And so I would suggest that our evidence there on the bottom left is evidence of this bottleneck effect. Yeah, we may have gotten VSH and some drone resistance, but we lost comb construction in the process. You know, these are the kinds of errors that natural selection can avoid. Okay, the effect of interest, mites. And here we have, there was no significant effects of VSH semen on mite levels, averaged across just the presence or absence of VSH. What can I say? That shows that a lot of our selection protocols are very, very sloppy. There's a lot of error built into our products of controlled selection. And in this case, all of those effects transpired to have no overarching effect. But you hear the but coming, don't you? And here's the but. When we looked at the interactions between polyandry and the presence of varroa-sensitive hygiene, things got more interesting. At the low polyandry rates of 1 versus 4 in Delaware, no effect of VSH. But in Georgia, there was a significant and favorable interaction between polyandry and VSH. We had a significant decline in mite numbers in those colonies in Georgia that had both VSH semen inseminated with 54 drones. I find this very useful. I find it very exciting. And it's also consistent with theory. Remember how I was talking earlier, how one of the reasons that selecting for queens to be promiscuous, and that's the word for it that we're talking about, isn't it here? queens that mate with many males. Natural selection rewards promiscuity in this case because she is flying with more males. She is capturing those finite, rare, beneficial genes, and she has to mate with a lot of males to keep those genes rare. What if she just happens to fly out and boom, the first drone she mates with is the good one? You know, he's got VSH. Well, if she stopped, yeah, she would have that hyper-specialized colony, wouldn't she? So it's a two-part process. She has to mate with a lot of drones to get those one or two good ones and a whole bunch more to keep those rare specialist genes, you know, rare. Okay, now let's look at survival. These are lumping the four things that we looked at, the two levels of VSH or wild and the two levels of polyandry. And these are just for Georgia, just for simplicity's sake. And the red areas is the proportion of colonies that survived the experiment. So red is good. Blue is bad. Blue is the proportion of colonies that died. So we see in the top left that there was a significantly better survivorship of the colonies across the board that had VSH semen, even though that did not translate into more brood, and even though that did not translate into overall fewer mites, it still improved overarching survival. I would suggest that this points out the preeminence of varroa as a mortality agent in honeybees today. It just shows how potent of a damager it is. And of course, this is all compounded with the viruses that they vector too, isn't it? On the top right, we found no overarching difference of polyandry across the board, not for survival, even though those early characters were good, brood, bee populations. Unfortunately, it didn't translate into better survival. But again, when we looked at the interaction between the two, look at the bottom chart. The overall best survival, once again, was in those colonies that were both highly polyandrous and with the VSH semen. So the overwhelming sum of these data show the benefits of interacting those two principles. And I think this is extremely practical information for beekeepers and bee breeders. We really do need to be intentionally looking at how we can interface those two principles, diversity in the nest with the genetic selection that many teams around the world have been successful at. We can have our cake and eat it too. We do applaud those teams that are selecting for varroa sensitive hygiene, those teams selecting for grooming behavior. Any resistance character out there that we may not even know about yet. These are good things for us to be finding those genes, but it really needs to be intentionally interfaced with increasing mating numbers to get the optimum benefit of all that work. Okay, there we have it. How honeybees use genetics to solve their problems. I want to talk a little bit more about what nature can teach us. We've already learned a big one, and that is genetic variants in the nest. And that's a biggie. Okay, that's my pet baby. That's why I stress it so much, but that's a big one. But let's look at some other things. There certainly is more to talk about. This is a map of planet Earth almost 30 million years ago. Pardon my alarm going off for my wash. What you're seeing here is a map of the Earth about 30 million years ago, and a very competitive theory that's out there right now about where the genus Apis originated. The traditional narrative is that Apis is a product of Southeast Asia. And the reason we think that is because that is where the greatest diversity of the genus is to be found today. Classically, in biogeography, we believe that to be generally true. An area of the Earth, a region that has the most diverse types of a particular taxon or species is probably where it first evolved in the first place. And then you see like a diffusion effect. As you move away from that point of origin, you find, you know, less diversity in that lineage. Well, okay, this paper that was published in 2013 said, you know what, we have an alternative proposal to that, because it just so happens that the oldest fossils for the genus Apis are not from Southeast Asia, They're from Central Europe. They're from Germany and France. These authors proposed that it was from this point of origin that the genus Apus evolved and then secondarily had two ancient lines that migrated out into Southeast Asia. And that is the two branches that gave rise to the modern diversity of Apus that we have there today. We have Apus serrana, the native host of the Varroa mite. We have Apus dorsata, the giant bee, Apus florea, Apus negra cincta. We have Apus nuluensis. There's a lot of other Apus species, and they're all in Southeast Asia. Well, these same authors had more to talk about. It seems that the genus was able to find its way across Beringia, the Bering Strait, and actually entered North America. I think most of us grew up knowing that Apus mellifera is an exotic, it's not native to North America, and that is true of Apus mellifera, but it is not true of the genus Apus. I'm proud to say North America does in fact have its own native Apus, except its name was given Apus nearctica, and Apus nearctica went extinct sometime after 14 million years ago because we have its fossils in Nevada. So I think that's pretty cool. The genus Apus actually did make its way here naturally into North America. And after it went extinct, the continent was in fact empty of Apus until historic times when Europeans brought mellifera to our shores. Now, the next important nugget there that I want to talk about is that arrow that's coming down from the point of origin in Central Europe, crossing the Isthmus of Iberia and moving into Africa. This is the lineage that appears to have given rise to Apus mellifera, the modern Western honeybee that you and I keep in our hives. I like this model for a couple reasons. Number one, here is a distribution of the modern natural ranges of Apus serrana and Apus mellifera. Notice that planet Earth has assumed her modern contours by this point. Serrana and mellifera, the eastern honeybee, the western honeybee. And their ranges are dramatically bipolar of each other, and they do not overlap. And I have always, as a student of entomology and a student of the honeybee, I've always puzzled over that. Why are their ranges so distinct? They don't even overlap. Well, this model of a European origin explains that. It also explains what to me has always been a mystery, and that is why alone of all of the Apus does mellifera and mellifera only not have its own natural mite. It doesn't. It's mite-free in its natural state. Why are all the mites restricted to Asiatic bees? This model explains that also. So it explains the modern distribution of these two species. It explains the geographic isolation of mellifera. And the model also explains why mellifera is so hard to select for Varroa mite resistance. When we as short-term, short-vision, myopic humans, when we approach a problem as huge as breeding for Varroa mite resistance in mellifera, this slide, this natural history, explains to us the magnitude of the task that we are trying to accomplish. Mellifera never had an exposure to Asiatic mites, according to this model, which is based on real fossil evidence. I think this is pretty compelling. Now that's not to say that mellifera has no resistance to Varroa, it does. I mean, I just talked about it, didn't I? Varroa sensitive hygiene. But in these cases, it's we as human breeders are co-opting machinery that originally evolved for another purpose. In the case of hygienic behavior, that was an evolved reaction to foul brood diseases, chalk brood, fungal diseases in brood. And yes, Mellifera can take those parts of that machine and they can retro work them and orient them toward varroa resistance instead, but it is a monumental task. And I throw this out there because I think we as breeders are sometimes treated a little too cavalierly, and we don't understand the magnitude of the problem when we are trying to select for resistance in Mellifera against this alien parasite for which it has zero history. There's nothing in its lineage that looks like a varroa mite. So anyway, there it is. Natural history, the history of our insect, gives us perspective, right? And that's worth something. Okay, going back to the African continent, we have that ancestral Mellifera stock that began radiating into a lineage called M that went up back north again. It retraced its old journey, this time going north and crossed into Iberia. And this gave rise to the modern day Mellifera and Mellifera ligustica, the German black bee and the Iberian Spanish bee. The C lineage went back up into Europe also a few years later, about 165,000 years ago, and it went up through the Levant, crossing the Suez Isthmus there, up into Anatolia and around the Black Sea, and down into Europe from the east. And this is the C lineage, which gives rise to the Carnica and the modern day Ligusta. Well, next we have the glaciers to thank. The glaciers got a piece of this action. In the last glacial maximum, we see that there was glaciers over the Pyrenees as well, which was called the Vermian glaciation, as well as the Riss glaciation over the Alps. And we can thank these glaciers for reproductively isolating those M and C lineages. And the M lineage broke up into two, Apis mellifera mellifera in continental Europe, and Apis mellifera iberiensis in the Spanish peninsula, all because the Pyrenees iced over and those two populations could no longer interbreed. The same thing happened in the Alps over northern Italy. Those Alps glaciated over and separated Carnica from Ligustica, so those two populations could diverge from one another. So we have the glaciers to thank for the modern races of honeybees that we use from Europe. But it is about Europe now. We're talking about Europe. We're talking about the M's and the C lineages that moved out of tropical Africa into temperate Europe, and they had to nest in hollow trees to survive these brutal winters. And my next door neighbors were gracious enough to allow this tree to fall, so I had the opportunity to photograph this bee nest inside it, and just take a look at that insulation. Holy cow. Compare that insulation to our 3/4 inch stock lumber that we use today. I think it's safe to say we could do a whole lot better. This is one of those low-hanging fruits. Mellifera is evolved to live and thrive in highly insulated cavities. We're doing better. There's companies, you know, out of Canada and elsewhere, they're making new engineered materials that are more insulated. I think this is a good thing. If you ever visit Eastern Europe, you see a lot of the beekeepers there, they intuit this problem better than we do. They have basically pillows that they put between their inner and outer cover. I think this is a good idea. I think this is one of those things that it's a no-brainer. We need to insulate our bees more. Swarming. We've always thought it's bad, right? Well, we kind of are changing our minds on that. We're finding that when colonies are allowed to go through their normal swarming cycle, that it interrupts the life cycle of pathogens and parasites, with the result of cutting down the overall parasite load in colonies that swarm. And Tom Seeley has shown this many times. I think this is cause for a ag economist to do a real risk-benefit cost analysis. It could be, I don't know, I'm just proposing, it could be that there might be some optimum where we manage our hives less intensely and let them actually swarm, and we may take a hit on individual hive productivity, but at the gain of much greater health and cost in savings for remedial chemicals that we use. I don't know that, I'm just proposing that. I think it's a very worthwhile problem. propolis. Those bees, whether they were in Africa or whether in Europe, used a lot of propolis in Africa to wall off invertebrate predators like ants, for example. In Europe, it would be to wall off, you know, nest invaders, to seal off the interior, to make it less friendly and conducive to pathogen growth inside the nest. And I remember when I was a kid growing up that it was a good thing to have bees that didn't make a lot of propolis. They actually advertised that for the queens in the bee journals. Our queens don't use a lot of propolis. You know, and this was considered a good thing. Well, now we know it's a bad thing. We want propolis in our hives. And one of my master beekeepers actually got a publication for her research project out of this, where she simply used different hive interior textures as an aid for increasing propolis hoarding behavior. And essentially everything she did was an improvement. She used saw kerfs. She used unplaned lumber on the inside of the boxes. And then she used propolis traps and stapled them to the side walls. You know, I think it's Man Lake who sells those propolis traps. They look like queen excluders, but you can staple that material to the interior of your hives and you dramatically increase the propolis hoarding. I think this is another no-brainer. Hive densities. We know that in wild, Apis mellifera generally nests itself about one every square kilometer, which is orders of magnitude less dense than apiaries, which are very common in our management schemes today. One of my students showed this very elegantly. He replicated apiaries of different hive densities where the hives were actually touching, the hives were 0 meters apart, or they were 10 meters apart, or they were 100 meters apart. And he inoculated one of the pair with 300 varroa mites, and then we tracked mite population growth over the summer until next fall. And he found significantly fewer mites in those apiaries in which the hives were spaced 100 meters apart. Now, there's a couple comments here. Number one, this shows how varroa is responsive to the brood available to it at the scale of a landscape. It's not just inside the hive. It's not just inside the apiary. It's at a landscape scale that the population of mites can increase. It's as if they are accessing all of the hives within an apiary scale. So if we can just simply, you know, reduce that and expand that spacing in between them, reduce the density, we will see fewer mites. The second comment, of course, is I am not going to tell a commercial beekeeper you got to space your hives 100 meters apart, right? But what I can tell beekeepers is here's the principle. Highly crowded apiaries are conducive to mite virulence, population growth, and virulence of those mites. What can you do in your operation to take advantage of that knowledge? I imagine most of us could probably reduce our density if we thought about it a little bit. We did another study where we were able to look at the fine scale genetic differences between bees and mites at the scale of an apiary. And we found there's actually genetic differences within a season, remarkably brief, within a season between the bees and the mites, which is good news for those of us who are interested in selecting for local resistance, because it shows that within a pretty brief time scale, we can see effects from our selection process. And another thing this showed that if you have a dead out in a yard, we have here the one on the far left, which is dead, the bees are straggling out into the grass. What do you do? Take it out and bring in a package? No. You don't want to do that. It would be far better to make up your dead outs from within that apiary if, in fact, you are engaged in a selection scheme. Otherwise, you're diluting the effects of your selection. We had one more study about this density thing that it's worth telling you. We were interested in the combined effects in this study, we were interested in visual complexity and the ability to drift. And we had apiaries that were set up either in a line like this with visual similarity, which was encouraging drift. And then we had them set up in circles with lots of visual difference. We had symbols painted on the surface and whatnot. And we looked at them for mites and other measures of strength. The mite levels were unaffected in this study because the density really didn't change. It was the complexity of the visual cues and the propensity to drift that changed. But what we did find different was honey yield. What you're seeing across this bottom axis is July of 2015, and the blue bars are the honey yields of these two different apiary types. And then we tracked it through October, March, and July, and September of the following summer. And in four of our five sampling dates, we had significantly more honey in those apiaries arranged in a circle with lots of visual cues. Now, this is interesting. Keep this in mind, the numbers of hives did not change. It was eight in a row or eight in a circle. And the area, the density was not that different. It was the visual complexity and their propensity to drift that differed. And in those colonies, which were in circles, those apiaries in circles, we had more honey. And it was consistent over these four sampling points of an entire year. I think that's pretty cool. So let us wrap up in the time we have left. What I've hoped to paint for you in this lecture is a big picture, just to let us know that if we are better students of our animal, I think we would find ways to be better managers of our animal. Honeybees are ancient, but they're not that ancient. Both they and humans are relatively late on the scene of natural history. We're at a scale of hundreds of thousands of years. We are, in fact, sympatric to one another. We have affected each other's evolution. They have affected us by giving us a very instinctive fear of stings. I privately think that they too probably fueled the development of our brains, because we know in Homo evolution that diet was a really important thing to speeding the development of our brains. And nobody's going to tell me that early Homo sapiens, or even earlier than Homo erectus and earlier species, nobody's going to convince me that they were not keenly aware of those bees nesting in hollow trees. And we know that they preyed upon them, and those are big caloric jackpots. So I privately think honeybees contributed to that dietary surge which fueled the development of the human brain and ultimately gave rise to humanity. Now, is that big or is that big? I think it's pretty darn big. Honeybees teach us that evolution is not just selfishness. Yes, it's true. Genes are selfish, but it is equally true that very often the best way to succeed is to cooperate. And cooperation is at least as important a message in the history of life as is selfish evolution. I think understanding bees and their natural context gives us realistic expectations for the breeding agenda that we try to design. European mellifera is adapted for winter. I think we could do a heck of a lot better that with the types of hive designs that we give them. So much of this is worth its own lecture, but winter starvation is the norm in Apis mellifera, not the exception. Tom Seeley teaches us from the 1970s, his thesis work, that up to 75% of first year swarms do not survive their first 12 months. 75% of them die in their first 12 months. And this is from the 1970s, before varroa mites. So I throw that out there to give you some encouragement. If you, like me, are losing lots of colonies every year, that's normal of the species. High winter attrition is the norm for mellifera. We know that swarming is good for health. We know that low density apiaries are good for health. And the final three bullets are so interesting that I will have to reserve them for my talk later this afternoon. So I think with that, we're kind of spot on time. And I will pause there and maybe we can eke out some questions.
Well, Keith, let me just say that that was very big and brilliant. So thank you so much.
My pleasure.
I think we all learned quite a bit of new information from the broad spectrum of information you shared with us. So thank you. We do have a number of questions. So let's see how we can do with questions. The first question, it says, Keith, is the sperm stored in the queen that was received from multiple drones mixed up and used randomly, or is it used sequentially?
Ah, excellent. In our case, we did mix it. We collect the semen, these tiny little capillary tubes. They're only about a millimeter or so wide. They're quite tiny. And we express the semen into a small little vial, and we literally mix it up. Got a little glass rod, and we mix it up, and then we draw it back out again, and then we inseminate each queen with an equal volume. But the bigger and the more important question was a second one. Is it used sequentially or randomly? And the bulk of the evidence is that it is used randomly. It's been a question asked many times, and so there's a lot of different answers to that. But if you add them up, the majority of the papers say that the semen is in fact used randomly, which is also consistent with theory, because otherwise the queen would not be experiencing the benefit of polyandry. You know, so it theoretically and empirically it shows that it is used randomly.
Great. Well, before I forget, I just want to say that I think it's, you know, we have this controversy always about intervention, man's intervention versus letting things go naturally. And I just love the idea that you've come up with a strategy that kind of uses the best of both.
Yes.
I also love the idea that you're doing your laundry during the conference. Without COVID, that would definitely not have happened. So
how times have changed.
That's awesome. Okay, so our next question is kind of a long one. So Matt Ford says, and the real question is, in a practical sense, are some of the IPM methods and general practices that limit drone populations going to be a negative effect on polyandry? Can we correct some of that problem by having substantial drone donor colonies? Matt doesn't breed his own queens other than natural supersedure. So he doesn't particularly focus on increasing the number of drones in his area, but maybe even not being a queen breeder, maybe he thinks perhaps he should be focusing on a few colonies that I purposely increase drone population just to increase the potential for polyandry.
It is a tension. There's no question, because there is a lot of IPM out there about, you know, sacrificing drones and freeze killing drones and whatnot. I tend to think that the effect size would be greater from highly polyandrous queens than the effect of killing drones in our colonies. So of the two practices, I would lean toward the more polyandrous way. Not only scientifically, but I think, you know, it's more quote natural. I mean, going out there and extracting all the drones from a colony is not cost-free. Even if you do feed it back to them, you know, there is a lot of energetic loss that's represented by that manipulation. So of the two tensions, I would err in favor of polyandry and increasing the mating numbers. Let me throw out one other little factoid that may be useful. I have no confidence whatsoever in these strings of papers that are out there, some of which are decades old, about where should you put your mating nukes compared to your drone source colony. Oh, they should be 1 mile away or 2 miles away or at this time of day or that time of day. Throw all that out and scratch it off of your worry list. It doesn't matter, because drone congregation areas naturally contain virtually all drones within a flight radius of all colonies. And if you do have some unsavory matings, like a brother and a sister, then it doesn't matter, because polyandry is probably counteracting that as well.
Okay, great. We have a question from Amy Owen. Do environmental factors affect gene expression? She's thinking about defensiveness increasing in a colony independent of factors such as dearth, disruption of the hive, etc. And she says she has particularly Apis mellifera scutellata in mind.
Yeah. Yes, it's not equal though. You know, some characters are very strongly environmentally expressed and others are not. And she's just happened to hit upon one of them that's, you know, extremely environmentally sensitive and responsive. I'm sure she's talking in the long term, though. Yes, long enough term, you will see, you know, some variable expression of that. But defense behavior is probably more explained by the higher density of predation and parasite pressure in ancestral Africa compared to Europe. The parasite and pathogen pressure is higher in Africa than in Europe. And so that is considered to be the big driver of those differences. Now, on any given day, of course, we all know that environment influences how they may behave. But in evolutionary time, it has more to do with the parasite pressure that they were evolved under. And the predators, and chief of whom, let me reinforce, is us.
Yes, we are. Okay, kind of a general common question. Is instrumental insemination counter to bees' evolutionary imperative?
It's simply a tool. It is the only means that we have to, really the only practical means we have to get the matings that we want to. In natural mating, in some insects, we have what we call nuptial gifts, where the male gives more to the female than just his sperm. You know, sometimes the components of the ejaculate have, for example, nutritive value. We don't really have evidence for that in the honeybee. We do know that in the hands of a really skilled operator, inseminated queens can be just as effective as naturally mated ones, at least to human observation. So I do not shy away from it. Now, I think one question that ought to be asked, if I may imagine a question that follows, is, well, how can we exploit this? You're telling us to have polyandrous queens, right? Well, so what? What can we do about it? Well, number one, artificial insemination. I mean, we have shown that, you know, as an effect of our studies. And I have long advocated for more and more beekeeper groups to invest in insemination devices and make them available to their membership, just like they do honey extractors. Secondly, I had a beekeeper of mine who's an engineer, and he pointed out to me that you can download 3D printable insemination devices for in the neighborhood of $15. So there you go. That dramatically brings it within range of most of us. We are also looking at a proxy method of accomplishing polyandry, and that is by mixing brood, which is something that a lot of beekeepers do already for strength and equalizing purposes. But if you think about it, if you bring in brood from lots of colonies and put them in one colony, you have temporarily achieved a paternity count of probably up to 70, 80 or more. So you get a flush of highly polyandrous workers coursing through the colony for the next few weeks. And so we're testing that right now. In fact, we got the data, we just haven't analyzed it yet. We're writing that up too. And then thirdly, and this sounds kind of crazy, but I think it, I'm just gonna throw it out there, we could possibly select for promiscuity. Seriously, the marketing possibilities of the names almost drop like fruit off a tree. Imagine what a good marketer could do with that. So there's ways, I think, and at least two of those ways are within reach right now: insemination and brood mixing.
That's great. Okay, Mark Summers asking, would you advocate for having more types of queens to increase genetics, or to keeping more acclimated queens as a better survival mechanism?
You know, I used to be kind of cynical about the whole local thing until we published that paper that I alluded to about 3/4 through my talk. And we were able to, A, find genetic differences not only between bees in an apiary, but mites in an apiary. And B, we saw those differences in the scale of one season, which genuinely, you know, shocked my socks off. I really did not expect to see that. But that shows us that you do get detectable genetic differences really fast in a breeding program. So that would lead me to recommend, I would probably continue using stock that you have locally, but I would try to increase the numbers of drones that you're breeding her with locally as well.
All right, cool. A question from Matt Ford. For the Georgia test, when you had 54 drones, was there any way to know how much relatedness or unrelatedness existed within the 54 drones that were inseminated?
What I can say is that the reason those numbers, they exist because they're multiples. 9 is a multiple of 54. So we had 9 drone source colonies. And for those who received 9 males, we got 1 male from each of 9. For the queens that got 54, we got 6 from each of the 9 colonies. So they ultimately all came from just 9 colonies. And we got the spread of difference that you saw, which is pretty impressive. So it was far more conservative than what you would see in nature. It was radically more conservative than what you would see in nature. Remember, in nature, you get hundreds of colonies represented in a drone congregation area. Yeah. So, I mean, like I say, our results are fantastic and they're conservative.
Great. Hey, so, you know, as being the host, I have the ability to ask a question that I'm interested in. I really like the presentation around the circular hive orientation. And as a fairly new beekeeper, I was always told that hive entrances should face basically southeast, but it looked like in the circle where they were not all facing in the same direction.
Yeah, that recommendation comes from averages of nest entrances in nature. And it's sort of, there is a bias toward that south facing aspect. But I would consider its effect size to be rather tiny. And I think in modern times, at least, bees rarely have the luxury of being that picky about their cavities. In their evolution, perhaps they weren't. But today they cannot afford to be that picky. I would lean toward the circles for the reasons that we show. There's less drift and there's bigger honey crops. And drift is generally probably not the best way to manage your bees, because we do know it propagates varroa.
Hey, that's great. I'm not sure that we got all the questions answered, but I just wanted to share with you that we have some comments as well. One of the comments was, I think this is the best overview lecture, and I've heard many. So well, beginning
that's very
some
kind of you to say. Thank you.
I appreciate it. We're very grateful that you're here. You're a gentleman. Do you have to go put the laundry in the dryer now?
That was the dryer that you heard.
Oh, okay. You have to go fold the laundry now?
Yeah, right. I'm going to go fold it now. There you go.
Well, you know, we're excited to have you back this afternoon. So I'm glad you're sticking with us. We're glad to have you with us in New Mexico. It's been really great to hear you face to face. Like I've told the other speakers, when you're here with us, you know, as a Zoom host, it actually feels like you're sort of physically here. So yeah. Welcome to New Mexico. We're very grateful for your research. Keep up the great work, and we're going to be following you and reading your results. So thank you so much.
Thank you kindly. Well, okay. I'll be back.
Okay.